You can support In the Past Lane with as little as $1 a month. Just go to the support page at our website, inthepastlane.com. Thanks. In 1974, historian and biographer Fawn Brody published a new biography, Thomas Jefferson, An Intimate History. What made this biography stand out was Brody's conclusion that the rumors of Thomas Jefferson carrying on a long-term sexual relationship with an enslaved woman named Sally Hemings were true. This claim triggered a vehement and vicious response from many scholars who simply refused to believe it. Here's what writer and historian Gary Wills wrote in the New York Review of Books. Two vast things, each wondrous in itself, combined to make this book a prodigy: the author's industry and her ignorance. One can only be so intricately wrong by deep study and long effort, enough to make Ms. Brody the fasting hermit and very saint of ignorance. Alas, 24 years later, DNA verification of the Jefferson-Hemings relationship proved that it was Fawn Brody's critics who were the ignorant ones. You are listening to In the Past Lane, the podcast about history and why it matters.
We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more
huddled masses yearning to breathe
consider
free.
Consider that we shall be as a city upon a hill.
That all men and women are created equal.
Give me liberty or give me death.
Nobody's free until everybody's free.
The government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
History matters because it's not just about the past. History's about us, here and now. It explains the world we live in and why things are the way they are. And history gives us insights into how to achieve a more just, peaceful, and prosperous future. So people, let's do this. Hi there, everyone. Welcome to In the Past Lane, the podcast about American history and why it matters. I'm host Edward T. O'Donnell, your historian at large, and this is In the Past Lane, episode 137, in which we learn the fascinating story of the lives of Thomas Jefferson's daughters, two of them white and one of them African-American. We are brought to you by SBI, Snoring Beagle International, and come to you this week from the Sally Hemings Studios, located in central Massachusetts. You can learn more about me, this podcast, and our guests at our website, inthepastlane.com, and on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and our YouTube channel. Guiding us along, as always, is our dutiful executive producer, Lulu Spencer. So, what's happening in the Past Lane of late? Well, lots of things, but mostly struggles with technology. I won't bore you with the details, but I had a computer problem that required the wiping of my hard drive. But when I reinstalled the software that I used to edit my podcasts, I couldn't get one really important function to work. It's the process that allows me to edit interviews using separate tracks for the voices. This glitch meant that I couldn't put out full episodes featuring interviews. Thankfully, I was able to record and edit the Monday morning pit stop segments, so I hope you've been enjoying them. But now I'm pleased to say that everything is fixed and more full episodes are on the way, so thanks for your patience. Also on the technology front, while I was going through all this, I discovered that the inthepastlane.com website had been hacked, so if you tried to visit the site a few weeks back, it redirected you to an offshore company selling discount pharmaceuticals like Viagra. Whew! I guess I should be thankful that it wasn't pornography. Anyway, that all eventually got fixed as well. In happier news, the O'Donnell household now has a new puppy. My wife and I are empty nesters, and our previous dog, who provided the snoring sound for the Snoring Beagle International promo, died a couple years ago. So we recently decided that it was time to get back into the dog business. And now we have a delightful, tiny cockapoo named Luna. After Luna Lovegood of Harry Potter fame, of course. We've discovered that having a puppy is kind of like having a baby in the house again, requiring that we build our daily schedule around her. But it's totally worth it. She's a delight. And if you want to see what Luna looks like, I post a lot of videos and pictures of her on Instagram, which is at In the Past Lane. All right, let's get on with this episode. I'll be speaking with historian Catherine Kerrison about her book on the three daughters of Thomas Jefferson. Okay, people, no need to hail an Uber. Your journey in the Past Lane begins now. All right, Edward T. O'Donnell, your historian at large, back here at In the Past Lane. And with me now is historian Catherine Kerrison. She is an associate professor of history at Villanova University, where she teaches courses on colonial and revolutionary America and women's history. She's the author of Claiming the Pen, Women and Intellectual Life in the Early American South, and her latest work, Jefferson's Daughters, Three Sisters, White and Black in a Young America. In the course of our conversation, Catherine explains, the lives of Jefferson's two white daughters, in particular Martha, who was educated in Paris and grew up to be an intellectual like her father. How Martha raised her own family at Monticello, where, quite ahead of her time, she provided her daughters with a level of education equal to that of her sons. How Harriett, the enslaved African-American daughter Jefferson had with Sally Hemings, grew up in very different circumstances. How Thomas Jefferson fulfilled his promise to Sally Hemings that he would free their children when they turned 21 years of age. What happened to Harriett Hemings when she settled in Washington, D.C. and began a new life passing as a free white woman. How these stories of Jefferson's daughters and their different fates reveal both the power of race and the fact that it's a socially constructed concept. Catherine Kerrison, welcome to In the Past Lane.
Thank you very much, Ed. Pleasure to be here.
Your book makes a fascinating contribution to basically what amounts to a radical rethinking of one of the key founders, Thomas Jefferson. And it's hard to know when it started, but certainly Annette Gordon Reed's work, aided by DNA analysis techniques that have only recently come online. All of these things have firmly established, beyond really any doubt, that Jefferson had a second family, and this one with an enslaved woman named Sally Hemings. And since we now know this, this means that Jefferson had three daughters who survived to adulthood, not two. Two of them were Martha and Maria, born to Thomas Jefferson's wife, Martha, and another daughter named Harriett, born to Sally Hemings. So maybe you could get us started off by talking about who these three women were and what their lives were like, and then we'll get into some of the details of their experiences as they head off in very, very different directions.
Okay, we'll begin with Martha and Mariah. Martha and Mariah were the daughters of Thomas Jefferson and his wife, Martha, and they were the only two children who survived to adulthood from that marriage. Martha was born in 1772, and Mariah 6 years later in 1778. And Harriett, the daughter of Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings, was not born until 1801. And by 1801, both Martha and Mariah were already having their own children. So just mm-hmm. to sort of contextualize them on a timeline. And so as the recognized daughters of a so-called legitimate lawful marriage, Martha and Mariah enjoyed all the privileges of a white elite girlhood in Virginia. And I think in their stories, for me, the time that the two girls, Martha and Mariah, spend in Paris really is a kind of pivot point in their lives, in their girlhood. So when Jefferson's wife, Martha, died in 1782, by that point, Martha, the elder daughter, was 10 years old. And she was Jefferson's companion in his grief over his wife's death. And when Jefferson is asked by Congress to go to France to represent the United States there in the diplomatic team, he takes Martha with him. And so in August of 1784, they arrive in Paris, and they don't leave for 5 years. They don't leave until September of 1789. And so Martha grows up in Paris from ages 12 to 17. And
very formidable period in her life.
Exactly, exactly. And that's precisely sort of the argument I make for Martha's life, that Jefferson places her in an elite French convent school where she is in an all-female community, this school, which is very much of a kind of business corporate venture. We have to sort of think of it in those terms. And it was headed by an aristocratic woman, a woman used to giving orders, getting her way, a rather mm-hmm. formidable personality in her own right. And there Martha is hobnobbing with the daughters of the French aristocracy, of English diplomats, and it's a whole new world where she is reading French literature and learning languages and a much broader education than she would have received had she stayed home in Virginia. Mariah, on the other hand, was left behind. She was little, 5, 6 years old, and Jefferson left her behind with his sister-in-law, with his dead wife's sister. And there, Mariah is educated in the context of elite Virginia plantation life. And so She, as she grows up, she's with her cousins and this beloved aunt and uncle. She finds what her elder sister Martha never had, which is a second mother and a second family. And so in her growing up, she actually is much more the Virginia Gentry girl than her older sister will become. However, very early, actually, in early 1785, Jefferson decides that he wants Maria in Paris with him. And it takes a couple of years of to-ing and fro-ing because Maria doesn't want to leave this beloved family.
Right.
Her aunt and uncle can't imagine what Jefferson is thinking in asking that this little girl cross the Atlantic. But in the end, as usually happens, Jefferson's will prevails, and Maria arrives in Paris in the summer of 1787 with her escort, her 14-year-old enslaved maid, Sally Hemings.
Mm-hmm.
And so just in terms of how Paris and this whole experience sort of shapes their lives, the argument that I make in the book is that this intellectual community, this all-female intellectual community, has an enormous impact on Martha and will shape her ideas of female education, female intellectual life, and that this is a project that she is going to take to her own children in her marriage after she returns from Virginia, and I think is going to kind of shape the lives of her children and particularly her own daughters. For Maria, it will be different. She will, I think, in time, she comes to enjoy her life in Paris, but there's no question that the entire time she is pining for Virginia. And so when they return in 1789...
After only 2 years, so she doesn't have much time to really kind of, you know, get fully immersed into that world that her older sister has clearly become.
Right. And she's younger, so she's not talking about the kinds of things that Martha is talking about as a teenager, like, you know, boys, courtship, marriage, and that kind of thing. So it is a very different kind of experience. And indeed, when she returns home to Virginia, she's 11 or 12 when she returns. So her education is complete, and actually she's going to come up to Philadelphia with her father when he is tapped by Washington to be Secretary of State. And so she's going to have time with her father in the national capital, and she's going to be sort of hobnobbing with the elites of the American Republic, early Republic. But that's going to be a very different milieu than Martha had in Paris, where aristocratic women are used to being listened to. Their thoughts matter. They create salons for the very purpose of discussing ideas. That doesn't quite happen in America, and certainly not in Virginia.
And so this difference accounts for the way their lives, they don't turn out completely different, but it's safe to say that Maria lives a more traditional wife of the planter gentry.
Exactly.
And Martha does marry into that, but has a very different approach to the world and approach to the way she raises her children. Why don't we focus on a little bit more on Martha? Because she, in a way, she does provide a great contrast. And she lives so much longer, and she's also so much like her father in lots of ways, and very, very close to him. So close that she moves into Monticello with her family in 1809. And she's by this point married, has 11 children. And I think I spoke to Annette Gordon Reed a year ago, and she referred to Monticello as a glorified bachelor pad, all about Jefferson. And then suddenly this brood arrives, and it's a very different world. And the physical, as you point out, the architecture, the way it's laid out, is really not accommodating to this large group of people. So what's life like for Martha and her family when they move into Monticello?
Well, by the time Martha moves into Monticello in 1809, she is still in the midst of bearing children. So she has her first child in 1791 and her last in 1818, right? So it's a long period of childbearing for her. But by the time she moves her family to Monticello permanently, now sort of remember that every time Jefferson came home during his presidency, He would gather his family there to be with him. But by the time they move in, Martha kind of takes on different roles for her father, as well as being mother to this expanding brood. And as you mentioned, 11 in total surviving children. And so she ensconces herself in a room that is not even sort of 15 feet by 15 feet. And there she is managing the daily sort of supervision of the household and of Jefferson's enslaved staff. Here is where she is sort of meeting and greeting visitors and sort of deciding who gets to meet with Jefferson and who does not. And here is where she is conducting her school for her own children. And so it's a rather cramped existence, particularly when you mentioned the architecture of the home. Let's not forget, of course, that when Jefferson came home from France, inspired by all he had seen here, he began what amounted to a 20-year renovation project.
Mm-hmm.
And he was particularly enamored in Europe of the idea of apartments. And so he constructed an apartment for himself, which visitors still see, of course, to this very day, of essentially a two-room library that is connected with what he called his cabinet, his office space, his desk, which is also sort of free-flowing, connected to his bedroom. And so he had essentially a four-room complex, all of which sort of flows beautifully, is lit by the southern exposure and with this beautiful light, whereas Martha is sort of facing the north and the east, which doesn't get quite the same light in this tiny little space. And so I sort of bring this out as a way to see, on the one hand, Jefferson was enormously proud of the superb education that his daughter gave to his mm-hmm. grandchildren. And visitors always remarked on how highly educated, cultivated, and sophisticated Jefferson's granddaughters were in their conversation and language ability, etc. However, the very space says so much about whose intellectual life was really valued, and the letters of Martha's children, daughters, really allow us to see this kind of intellectual life, both reading and writing, that's kind of done on the fly,
right,
sort of in between their own household duties. Or what I found particularly poignant was how Martha's daughter Virginia absolutely crows with delight when she converts this attic space on the third floor underneath the dome, completely covered in cobwebs, inhabited by wasps and occasional wasps mm-hmm. that she saw. But she calls this her fairy palace as she hauls up a couch and a couple of chairs and a table. And this is going to be her private space she called a fairy
right.
palace. And it's so striking to kind of compare that with Jefferson's gorgeous sunlit apartment, the sage of Monticello, where all, you know, the inspired ideas of the American Enlightenment have come from.
Right, it is quite the contrast. And I've seen that space, and it is really tiny.
Yes.
And it gives you a sense of how crowded the house was and how hard it was to find a quiet place. And just to point out, you were saying how highly educated and cultured the women were. The contrast, of course, these visitors are seeing these as, you know, elite women, but they're far more educated than other elite women just a few miles away, right down to reading, learning Latin, getting a really complete classical education, and, you know, reading Virgil in the original. They are quite a striking group of highly educated, intellectually stimulated women.
Yes, and I think the fact that they learn Latin, and I haven't figured out how they did, if they sat in on lessons with their brothers, but Jefferson did not provide that kind of education for Martha and Mariah. They did not learn Latin. That was seen as a male accomplishment and achievement. But Martha somehow or other ensured that her daughters had that exposure. And Ellen particularly loved it and reveled in it. And in this, Martha was quite ahead of trends in the early Republic, towards the greater attention to the education of girls and women in both the North and the South. So she is doing in private what doesn't happen in female academies for at least another decade or two. And this whole project of showing that women too can be rational creatures was important to her. What was striking to me, and was always striking to me, is the way in which, however, that did not then translate as a proof for why women should be included as part of the American polity. I mean, this was the whole Enlightenment project, that because men were rational creatures, they were capable of self-government.
Right.
As Martha is educating her daughters and is herself proof that women too can be rational creatures, they don't then take that to its logical conclusion, therefore that women too should be part of the polity. And, you know, there's no indication that Martha or her brilliant daughter Ellen ever sort of looked at their famous father and grandfather and said, well, so then if we as intellectually capable as men, why can we not govern ourselves as well? They never do that. And of course, that has everything to do with growing up in a slave society.
Right.
And so in the end, I think they are very much, and this is another important point in the book, the way in which elite white women will use their race or their racial superiority, as it has been constructed by law and custom for a couple of hundred years, to differentiate themselves from the people they see as inferior, that is, their enslaved population. And so I don't shy away from what is, in truth, the racism of elite white women in this society, but also to show, of course, how limiting that is and how that keeps elite white women tied to the patriarchal project of their fathers and husbands.
Right, despite how educated and clearly capable they've become, they have very few options beyond just simply learning on their own. And you point out some of the frustrations they feel that they reveal in their letters, and also in thinking about their mother after Martha dies in the 1830s, they're saying, well, this great woman is going to disappear from history. You know, isn't this a tragedy? So there's a real sense of that warded opportunity among them. But let's, for reasons of time, why don't we at this point switch from Martha and this remarkable life that she's led in her role at Monticello to her sister Harriett, who was born in 1801, daughter of Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings. So the challenge you face throughout the story of Harriett is figuring out what her life was like with very little in terms of material evidence. So what do we know about Harriett's life at Monticello? And then we can move on to when she departs in the 1820s.
Okay, so I'll start with what we know from the historical record, most of which has been produced by white people. And so what we know from Jefferson kept what we call a farm book, in which he, not systematically, but occasionally sort of recorded aspects about his plantations, the slaves he owned, the allotments he would make of blankets and clothing, his plans for the harvest, all that kind of thing. So it's in there where he keeps a record of the people that he enslaved over the course of his lifetime. And so there's information in there. So from the farm book, we know that Harriett was born in May of 1801. We know that by the time she's 15, she is working in his textile manufactory or his textile workshop as a spinner, and that she is working with wool, which is a little bit easier on hands than flax. We know that, again, from Jefferson's farm book, he noted under her name and her older brother, Beverly, there's a notation in his hand that they had run, as in run away.
Right.
In 1822, now by May of 1822, Harriett had turned 21. So that's what we know from Jefferson's record. And then in 1873, her younger brother, Madison, who by this time was living out in Ohio, told the family story to an Ohio newspaper, and there he added some details about their life as children growing up at Monticello. And so there is where I get a little bit more of the texture of her childhood. So that's mm-hmm. where I find out, for example, that Sally Hemings' children have a different childhood than any other enslaved children that Jefferson ever owned. And so Madison said, for example, that they were not put to work until they were 14 years old. Of course, Madison was 4 years younger than Harriett, so he didn't have a perspective on her own childhood. But
right.
still, it gives us a clue. And what's significant about that is that, again, in Jefferson's farm book, he writes how he's putting enslaved children to work by the time they're 10 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that Sally Hemings' children had until about 14 says that Sally Hemings' children grew up with their mother, not separated from her. And so their daily rounds, that they would have spent a great deal of time with her. And again, we need to sort of remember that Jefferson is not living in this house full time until 1809. So for the first 7-8 years of Harriet's life, she's able to be with her mother, sort of perhaps run an occasional errand or whatever. But it's not sort of, except for the times when Jefferson's in residence, her mother's attention was probably pretty much directed to her own children. And again, this is not the norm
right.
for enslaved children. And then when she turns, well, we don't know exactly when Jefferson put her to work at sort of spinning, but I think this is sort of another thing to distinguish in terms of her childhood versus most enslaved children's childhood, is that she's not put to work in the fields. She is put to work in a small building that Jefferson had actually built about 10-15 years earlier as a home for white workers who were working on this grand renovation project of his. So it's not as a sort of manufactory, it's not a very large building. And it's headed by a female slave. So there isn't a male overseer. She's in a protected environment, indeed literally steps from the main house. So, again, relative to most enslaved children, she is not doing the hard manual labor out in the fields. She is not being supervised by a male overseer. And she is, as I say, literally steps from her father and mother's home,
right.
the great house of Monticello. And the other incredibly significant fact of this childhood, this girlhood from 14 until 21, when Jefferson freed her, was that unlike most female slave girls, there is no suggestion at all that she ever had a child. So she, this environment, this job protected her from sexual assault from men, whether, you know, sort of other white laborers who were at Monticello. So, you know, can't overstate the significance of that and of how peculiar that is in an enslaved girl's childhood.
Right. And then the thing that really sets her apart is what happens in 1822, which is that unlike most enslaved women, she is freed by Thomas Jefferson. He gives her $50 and puts her on a coach, and a coach headed for Washington, D.C. And that's a pretty remarkable moment. And what happens to Harriet, and what happens to the evidence trail, and what do we know about the life that she begins to lead? You noted that her brother spoke to a newspaper 51 years later in 1873 and told some of her story, which is really why we know the little we know about her. But what else did you find about Harriet when she arrives in D.C. and the life that she begins, this very different new life, passing as a white woman because she is, by mathematically speaking, 7/8 white. So she's capable of doing that which other enslaved women are not.
Exactly. So the first thing I want to just sort of underscore is what you said about how unusual it was to free a perfectly healthy enslaved woman. And in fact, Jefferson did that once and only once, and mm-hmm. with Harriett. So because, of course, well, Jefferson himself said that a woman who is capable of bearing children every other year is worth more than the most valuable man on the farm. And so that's a really important, crucial fact, and can only be understood in the context of the story that Madison told in 1873 about the treaty that his mother and father entered into in Paris, that any children born of their relationship would be freed at 21. And we know from Jefferson's overseer, Edmund Bacon, that Jefferson paid for her stagecoach fare actually all the way up to Philadelphia, although there's no evidence that she actually made it that far, and gave her $50 for her travel expenses. And so the rest of the story, again, sort of in terms of the documentary record, then comes from Madison's account, this account of 1873, in which he said that she thought it to her interest to go to Washington as a white woman, that she married a white man, in his words, in good standing in Washington City, that, again, in his words, she raised a family of children, and no one ever guessed that she was Harriett Hemings Monticello. And so, relying entirely on Madison's words, I concentrated my search for Harriett in Washington, D.C. I wanted to see if we could find out more particulars of her story. And my way of sort of looking for her initially was thinking, as Annette Gordon-Reed said in her book on the Hemingses of Monticello, that the Hemingses had a positive mania for naming children after relatives, and with the distinctive names of Harriett's brothers, Beverly, Madison, and Eston, I thought, well, perhaps if I look for a Harriett who had sons that bore one of those names, that might at least give me a clue. And so that was my initial idea about how to find her. As it turns out, genealogists would know this. The District of Columbia didn't keep birth records until the 1870s. And so what I did find was that beginning in 1811, all marriages in the district had to be registered with the district. And so I went through the marriage register up until 1830, culled out all the Harriets who married between sort of late 1821, the earliest she would have been there, and 1830, by which point she was 29. I think she would have been safely married. 19th century white women, that was the best option for financial security. And I wound up with a list of 58 Harriets and 58 husbands. And then with going through all the records in Washington and census records and wills and newspapers and church records and the marvelous records at the Library of the Daughters of the American Revolution, I started essentially doing a process of elimination, because in that marriage record, there wasn't, of course, a single Hemings. Harriett and her brother Beverly, who did the same thing, which is to say went to Washington as a white, freeborn white person, married into a white family and likewise disappeared from the record, they didn't keep their last name. And so so it would sort of be a process of elimination. If I found a baptismal record, for example, for a Harriett, well, then I could clearly eliminate her. If a Harriett was a woman of color, I could eliminate her. If a Harriett married a man of color, I could eliminate her, because Madison had said that his sister married a white man. So the other thing that Madison said in 1873 was that he hadn't heard from his sister in about 10 years. So at that point, he didn't know if she was still alive. And so that told me to look for a woman who lived probably at least until 1860 or so. And so a woman who died in childbirth in the 1840s wasn't her. So through all of this, in looking at all these people's lives, I got a picture of the Capital District as it's growing, I got a picture of what it might have been like as, let's say, a middling level housewife that Harriett would have had, the market she would have visited, the kinds of work that her husband might have been doing, the patterns of childbirth, infant mortality rates, and just kind of watching Washington grow from really kind of a town in a swamp that had a few homes, a couple of striking buildings, the Capitol and the President's House, but a whole lot of nothing in between.
That's right.
But I also looked at Black life in the city, both free and enslaved.
That was a really interesting, because you're basically trying to imaginatively construct what the world of Harriett was, because she's ultimately unfindable, at least at this stage. So yeah, the kind of life she would have lived as this middling level white woman in a reasonably prosperous household, but lurking all around her are these, as you point out, are these glaring reminders of what it would be like to be considered black, to be considered enslaved. And that's a really poignant part of your book. Tell us about some of these things that kind of, she can't go very far, or not too many days can pass by without her being constantly reminded of that status that she's left behind, and that, you know, the fear that she might be exposed, that must have been part of her life as well.
What was important for me to do, as you point out, she was sort of ultimately unfindable. However, we could still learn a lot about what her project of passing meant to her. And my way of doing that was to try to see Washington through her eyes, and to ensure that in my telling of her story that I don't present her successful project of passing as triumph and as a happy ending, right? And so part of that, of course, had to be the fate that she avoided by presenting herself as a freeborn white person that she could see every day. And so there were literally, so Washington, D.C. was a kind of transport depot for the traffic of slaves. There were places where slaveholders could take misbehaving slaves for correction if they didn't want to do it themselves. And in fact, Martha Jefferson Randolph, and later in her life when she's in Washington, would actually send one of her slaves to a place like this. So you could see slaves being paraded literally down Pennsylvania Avenue. There were riots against successful black businesses in the 1830s. So there was the prosecution of what would have been a remarkable slave escape of about 70 slaves who were headed to a ship called the Pearl, but who were captured before they could make it. So there were all sorts of reminders. And then there was the ways in which even free blacks in Washington, their own economic aspirations were limited to sort of the most menial of jobs. And then the other thing that you mentioned was, that you asked about, was, again, kind of what the stakes were for Harriett passing as this freeborn white woman, and particularly as the mother of, a family that Madison said that she had. And so when I said that Harriett was freed by Jefferson, it's more accurate to say that Jefferson let her go and certainly facilitated her departure, but he never formally freed her with freedom papers. So legally, at law, she was a slave. Her status as an enslaved woman continued until the passage of the 13th Amendment that abolished slavery in the United States in 1865.
And the same was true of her children.
Exactly. And so by law, children inherited the status of their mother. So if their mother was enslaved, the children were enslaved. And this was sort of true. These laws were upheld in various ways, even in the North, which is to say with the various fugitive slave laws, the people in the North were bound to support, as it were, to enforce this law in the South that children inherit the condition of their mother. And so the Emancipation Proclamation didn't free her because she was living in the District of Columbia, not in a rebellious territory. The Emancipation Law in the district in April of 1862 didn't free her because she wasn't living as an enslaved person. So there was always this risk of not just herself being outed, as it were, as an enslaved person, but the appalling prospects for her own children. So this had to have informed her life on a daily basis. And I think that this is an important thing, that this project of passing, both in her own time and even with all the meanings of blackness and whiteness in our own society today, that passing always brings with it or carries with it these tensions, these fears, and it's not an alloyed story of triumph. It's tragic, I think, as well.
Right. Because in addition to all this anxiety and these, you know, daily reminders, the other aspect of passing was that she had to basically completely cut herself off from her family. It sounds like she corresponded with her brothers, perhaps, but she probably didn't know what happened to her mother until being informed later that Sally Hemings had died. And so part of that deal you make is to completely renounce your family and any kind of ties to it in order to gain access to a life of dignity and equality before the law and so forth that is only accorded to white people in that era. So it's a big, big trade-off that probably was on her mind throughout her life.
Exactly. You know, I think I literally cannot imagine that moment of her departure, of farewell to her mother and her two younger brothers, knowing that she would never see them again. Right, so it's that kind of death that slavery brought with it all the time when families were separated by sale. I mean, there are ways in which Sally Hemings was protected from that fate. Her children were never sold away from her, and so she sort of had the comfort of that. Nonetheless, she still suffered the loss of her two elder children because of sort of this insidious society, slave society, that white people had built. And again, this sort of separation from family, I mean, clearly she kept in touch with Madison somehow. Now, whether that was through her brother Beverly, who also, as I said, left and went to Washington, he actually married a Maryland woman. So, of course, it's always my hope that they were at least able to maintain that family connection. But somehow, Madison was kept informed of his sister's life. But this kind of separation, this cutting off of yourself from your birth family, from your origins, is a choice that not only sort of Harriett and Beverly made, but again, that I have to emphasize that people still are making these choices today.
That's right.
That we can't sort of think of, oh, that this just happened during the times of slavery. That race still matters. These racial categories still matter so much in contemporary American life that people are still making these incredibly difficult choices, but to carry them out successfully, it frequently means utterly leaving those family members, those connections behind completely, and not hearing of a parental death till years after, never being able to attend the funeral of a parent because you've established this life as a white person and you don't dare risk it.
Right. So much is riding on it.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Well, by way of concluding, this has been a fascinating conversation. And I always ask the people that are, you know, the historians that I interview to sort of bring forward the topic. So your topic is very much set in the late 18th and 19th century, but you've already begun to address it. But maybe just by way of concluding, what is in this story of these three sisters that has relevance for our times today?
Well, I think for Martha's story that particularly for elite white women today who are college educated, who sort of think that their productivity, that their achievements at the intellectual level will break down the barriers of gender, say, in the workforce, that's not necessarily going to be true, that there are still ways in which being male and being female are defined. And so part of what I want this book to show is the very long and deep history of this, and to help readers understand why, for example, when a woman runs for the highest office in the land, she is subjected to so much vitriol about her gender and how her gender does not fit her for such an office.
Yeah.
Because there are so many times when people think we're living in a post-feminist society, and then these kinds of things happen and people are puzzled about, well, I thought we got rid of this. And so I think there's a way, there's a way in which Martha's story kind of helps us sort of understand why these, what seems to be sort of contradictions, still exist. I think her story and that of her daughters is also important in demonstrating another story of, you know, kind of great historic import, and that is the division between white women and women of color, and why they haven't aligned along gender lines, right? And to show the ways in which white women's racism has been complicit in sustaining racist society or racially organized society. And with Harriett's story particularly, I think for several different things. First of all, of course, I want readers to understand that race is an artificial category. It has absolutely no scientific foundation in biology. I want readers to see that such artificial constructions, I sort of show them how it was built. And my hope is that in seeing this, that readers will understand, well, such artificial constructions can be torn down, right? If they're not based in nature.
Right.
They are eminently changeable. And that when we see the founders' imperfections, and certainly I try certainly to give Jefferson credit where credit is due, but on the other hand, I don't shy away from his flaws as a father or as a founder. But I do think that in a way, it can really be quite freeing to see the founder's flaws and to realize that it's not really a matter of us today trying to go backwards to measure up to what the founders did, but rather to acknowledge their flaws, to build on what is good and what is the best from our founding period, and to make it better.
Right. History, we often crave history that's very simple, and that, you know, we crave icons that are simple, you know, one-dimensional heroic figures or marble statues, you know, the like the founders. But history is actually more interesting and way more informative and instructive when it's more complicated and we take into account flaws and mistakes and see the American experiment, as Jefferson and others referred to it, as an ongoing thing that we need to contribute to and to guide in our time, whatever that time might be. So I think that's a good point to end on. Well, Catherine Kerrison, this has been a very interesting and informative conversation about a really, in many ways, a hidden chapter of the American history and the founding period and a dimension of Jefferson that has long gone overlooked. So thank you very much for taking the time to speak to us at In the Past Lane.
Oh, my pleasure indeed. Thank you for having me.
Catherine Kerrison is the author of Jefferson's Daughters, Three Sisters, White and Black in a Young America, published by Ballantine Books and available everywhere. I hope you enjoyed this episode. If you want to show your love for the podcast, you can buy some of our merchandise. Just go to inthepastlane.com and click on merchandise. There you'll see more than 50 t-shirts with In the Past Lane logos, not to mention a whole line of shirts with history quotes from notable people like Abraham Lincoln, who once said, "Fellow citizens, we cannot escape history." And Mark Twain, who said, "History does not repeat itself, but it does rhyme." And remember, everything you see at our merchandise page comes as a hoodie, water bottle, coffee mug, stickers, you name it. So check it all out at inthepastlane.com. Thanks. Okay, people, that's all for this episode of In the Past Lane. Thank you so much for tuning in. For more information about the many things we talked about today, head over to our show page for this episode at inthepastlane.com. If you like what you've heard, please subscribe to this podcast at Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, Spotify, or wherever you access your podcasts. I'm In the Past Lane's host, Edward T. O'Donnell, your historian at large, reminding you that history explains our world. So let's pay attention to it. Thanks for listening. We hope you'll join us next time for another journey in the past lane. Hey, Lulu, I think we need to give this place a cooler vibe. How about we get a ping pong table and beanbag chairs and such?
How about we don't?
SBI, Snoring Beagle International.